Welcome back to the Coptimizer podcast. Today, I have Alan Hendrickson, and his story is very unique. It's fascinating, quite frankly, and I can't wait for all of you to get a peek behind the curtain into the life of Alan Hendrickson. And I think there's some cautionary tales here. I think there's some great lessons. And most importantly, Alan has some wisdom that he's going to drop on us that I think we're all going to appreciate. 21 years in policing. He's done a lot over his career. He's an instructor. He's been named Officer of the Year, certified post-investigator in the state of Alabama, Elite Command Leadership Institute training, FBI certified negotiator. But where we're going to kind of focus in on a lot of this conversation today is the work that he's done in peer support training, and get a little bit of background on that. And I don't mean to make light of this, but for the cops that are listening to this podcast, they're just going to shake their head and go, yep, okay, I get it. But Alan's been married to the same woman three separate times. And so Alan may have been Officer of the Year, but I think his spouse may be spouse of the decade, spouse of the century, because it's not easy being married to a police officer. And police officers carry a lot of baggage with them. They see a lot of things. They experience a lot. And Alan did just that in his career, because a significant amount of his time he spent working in narcotics and working undercover. And from there, I'm going to kick it over. Welcome to the Coptimizer podcast, Alan. Thanks for being here.
Good morning. Good morning. I'm excited to be here.
So we met through some mutual connections through the coaching profession and the Axon coaching program. And you have such a unique story that I couldn't wait to get you on the show to talk about this, because people are going to learn a lot. So tell me, let's just get it right out of the way. How does somebody marry the same person three times, and how does she put up with you?
Well, in the beginning, I wasn't dealing with my stress right when I first got in law enforcement, which drove me to make some decisions of infidelity, alcoholism, just went down the wrong path, and did not realize until after I started correcting those paths that I had a wonderful woman. Again, we have been married three times. During those times, she has always stayed faithful while I was out doing things I didn't need to do. So definitely have learned a lot over the 20 plus years in law enforcement on how to deal with stress correctly.
Well, I spent some time working with the narcotics task force, went to the narcotics supervisor school. What are the three things that they teach you that are always going to get you in trouble when you're working narcotics?
Women, alcohol, and drugs. Those three things will get you in trouble. Informants, dealing with informants on the drug side. So that would lead to infidelity and things like that.
Well, and I don't mean to sound flippant. I'm trying to make light of a very serious conversation and a serious topic. First of all, you know, I just appreciate the work that you've done, because that's not easy. And, you know, having some experience in that arena, I never did undercover work myself. I'm a fair skinned Irishman, and you can read me like a book. So, you know, if I'm getting nervous or if I'm getting mad, I mean, it's just like, you might as well just put a sign on my forehead that says cop. it would have never worked. Now, I did enjoy the surveillance work and the hard dig in the data and really just kind of digging into targets. You know, that stuff I really enjoyed. But you know, there was much braver men and women than me that were going out and doing the hand to hands and doing the undercover work. And but that's not easy work. So tell you know maybe let's go back a little bit and talk, because, you know, before we started recording, you were telling me, you know, you started working in the jail, which is a very, you know, that's a typical path for a lot of police officers. You're young, you get exposure to the criminal justice system and policing by starting in the jail. So where did you start your career, and what was that like?
I started my career at a local agency, sheriff's office here in Alabama. I started off as a reserve officer. Then I went to work in corrections, worked in corrections a little over a year, applied to be a deputy, got hired, started working patrol, your normal patrol as a deputy, serving your papers, doing different types of things that deputy does versus a police officer. And then an opening come up in narcotics. So I put in for that transfer and was transferred to narcotics, worked a career in narcotics for about 4 years at that agency. During that time, I was assigned to multiple drug task force from the federal down to the state. What that entailed was, during that time, I would go and work undercover in different agencies, actually purchasing, you know, narcotics as an undercover officer. You live in that lifestyle. And as those years went on, there was not a lot of training to stop you when you came home and back to society. So when you'd come home, you'd tend to bring those traits of living, being that undercover officer back home after a while. So when you were at home, you were still doing things that you were doing as an undercover officer that really you didn't need to be doing, which would lead to the infidelity, the drinking, the partying. Because most of your undercover, you know, you are partying with these people that you're buying narcotics from, or stolen property, whatever it might be that you're detail is. Sometimes you're doing drugs, sometimes you're doing stolen property like firearms and things like that. Definitely at the time there was not a lot of training, and that sends you to a downward spiral during that time if you don't watch out and take care of yourself mentally.
Yeah, so training I think is the is the key, right? And an awareness of what you're getting into before you get into it. And you know, one of the themes for our podcast and the Coptimizer concept really has been, okay, let's learn from things that we've done well. Let's learn from things that we haven't done well, you know, from a profession perspective. And, you know, a lot of what people's ideas about how law enforcement works are formed from the media writ large, Hollywood, stuff like that. So, you know, you're talking, you know, 20, 25 years ago when you started this work, and we were just really, I think, on the cusp, I think, as a whole for our profession, starting to recognize that some of our failures are administrative. They're not individually based, but they really start in this system in which we're putting people to work in. And narcotics is, you know, that's a tough job. And, you know, you can, there's some pretty good movies that are out there, I think, that depict that lifestyle well. But for what you were doing is actually, it's very rare in law enforcement. People think that, oh man, there's undercover cops running all over the place. And that's just not the case. That's a very unique skill set in a very small subculture of the policing profession. So when you say, I think for me, it was just fascinating to know that you were, as a very young officer, early 20s, traveling around the state and maybe even outside of that, not coming home for weeks on end and actually taking on the persona of this drug dealer, this gun dealer, thief, whatever it might be. And, you know, that's when you're doing that, you got to sell it. And some people are just really natural at it and they can do it very well. And they have this ability to kind of split their brain, like, all right, I'm in the policing world right now. I'm in my UC role and now I can turn it off and now I switch back. And I think the longer you do that, the more difficult it becomes to separate your identity as undercover officer from your identity as dad, husband, wife, whatever that might be, depending on depending on the individual. So what was that like those first few years when you were doing that?
You said it very well. When you start doing the undercover, after so many undercover details, it is very hard to start separating. And I think that's where the problems start becoming a problem. The first few undercovers, you go in and you learn the community. The information is given to you about who you're going to be potentially making a purchase from, whether it's property or drugs or identity thefts, things like that. You then start working that and you start molding yourself to be like them because the research has been done and given to you. I think the hardest battle there is after many undercovers, when you do come home, you tend to forget to separate the two. So I think you said that very well. And that's where later on in my career, I learned how to separate the two, but not until after I had really hit rock bottom. As I became more and more undercover, I began drinking more, began to do the infidelity. At one point, I got out of law enforcement for about 4 years. Then I got back in law enforcement. When I got back in law enforcement as a regular patrol deputy, I was assigned to patrol. I was involved in an officer-involved shooting where the subject did die. So then I hadn't dealt with all the problems from the undercover yet. So that added to it. And then I really started doing a lot of drinking. And that was the second, about that time frame is about the second time the wife and I divorced. So as that progressed along, nobody really said, hey, you got a problem. I was a married man living with a married woman. That agency at the time knew it. And nobody really tried to stop it until I really spun out of control with the drinking. And that's when I, in 2015, went to rehab and began the process of fixing all of the disasters that I had created in my work career and my personal life. I think what we don't realize as officers, every day our spouse and children go to work with us. When we leave, they go to work with us. They're hoping we come home okay. So we had to learn the proper way of coming home, taking off the bad, becoming a human again, and dealing with all those things.
Yeah, and that's a lot. So how old were you when you first started working narcotics? Do you remember how old you were?
46. So I was in my early 20s.
Okay. Early 20s. So and now we know from the science today that the male brain may not even be fully developed until age 25, you know, in particular, the prefrontal cortex, where we're talking about the consequence portion of the brain, the if then. So, and everybody's obviously a little bit different. So you take a young, inexperienced officer, and you put them into an environment where they're taking on an alternate persona, and then you're exposing them to things that they just may not be ready to be exposed to. So the temptation is there, the understanding of the consequences of poor decision making, and so you know I don't know. Did you ever watch 21 Jump Street when you were a kid?
I might have. I don't remember, honestly.
Well, you know, the modern version with John, you know, is not Johnny Depp, but it's pretty funny. But the younger version, you know, that there was a lot of people that were kind of like, oh, yeah, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go join the police department. Then I'm going to go back to high school, going to work narcotics. If they made a movie about it, it happened somewhere. You know, that's we pretty much. All these good ideas and funny stories or, you know, real drama, you know, they tend to have roots in reality, but that, that's a lot. So your agency at the time, and again, this is not to point fingers because I do think that we've learned a lot, but can you walk me through, some of the training that you did receive or that you remember receiving before you had these responsibilities?
Well, once you're assigned at that particular agency, as most agencies, once you're assigned to investigations, whether it's narcotics or general investigations, they have a set amount of training that you have to attend. So I did attend training, but the training was not focused mentally or on yourself. It was on how to be undercover, how to talk to people so that they can communicate with them and become comfortable to be able to make your transaction, if you want to call it a transaction purchase. So none of the training was really on you as a person. It was all focused toward how to make you a better undercover and what you do in that capacity, what you could do if you got in trouble and you needed help. So again, the training for the position itself was very good. What we liked at the time was mental and personal training. You know, for years, if you're a police officer and you all of a sudden say, hey, I have a mental problem or I'm stressed out, you kind of got a black eye and agencies wouldn't hire you. And that's why we have such a high suicide rate, highest divorce rate. I think we're second or third divorce rate highest in most professions. I believe it's number two or three of the divorce rate. And then the suicide rate, if you look at the numbers on suicide, again, the training was great for the job, but the training as an individual for the individual person at the time was very lacking, where now we have training getting done. So glad to see that.
Yeah, that's incredibly important. And one of the things that we're going to focus on later in this conversation, because and I've said this multiple times across different podcasts, I think, you know, historically in policing, we have been very good at teaching the technical and the tactical skills, right? How to survive in the moment on the street, right? How do you survive a gun battle? How, you know, the defensive tactics, although there's a strong argument that could be made that we need to do a lot more of that stuff. And I certainly believe that's true as well. From a perspective of an individual officer, we're learning how to shoot, move, and communicate, right? That's what we're doing. And where's my rapid action team if something goes wrong? So you're doing all of these things and preparing well, but what we're not preparing well for is, okay, well, when you go home or when you're done with that, how do you decompress? Process what you've been doing and compartmentalize it in a way that's going to be beneficial over the long term. So none of that training existed. And the old model again is, we got people lined up outside the door waiting to come into the profession. So if somebody fails, you know, on the job, you know, we can, you know, we do a good job of breaking officers, you know, exposing them to trauma and stress and a volume of work that can be very difficult to maintain. And then when we have disciplinary issues, I don't think historically we were good at getting people the resources to try to fix them before that happened. And then it's just next officer up. But you've done a lot of work to change that. And I think that your personal experiences, I think, are what are so compelling when you start telling the story about, okay, well, not only did I make this mistake once, I came back, I had another trauma related incident, and I went down the same path. And then maybe we just pick up from there. You've had your shooting, you're not processing that trauma well. You go back to coping mechanisms that are familiar to you, that you've used in the past. That's alcohol, infidelity. So what happens next?
Well, at the time I was living with another married woman that worked with me, and I was married. We, you know, I had a night that we didn't have a good discussion. So at that point, that's when my job at the time got involved, and They told me I had a drinking problem. So that was in 2015. So I came home. I was sitting around my home. By then, the person that I was living with had moved out. So at this point, I have my family's not with me no more. The lady that I was living with's not with me no more. I don't have a job. So I'm sitting there thinking, what do I do? So I get in my vehicle. I drive down to the local liquor store. I buy the liquor that I usually drink, a big bottle. I go home, start researching. I have not opened the bottle yet. I start researching rehabs. I then decide to get myself enrolled in a rehab. I packed my clothes, not knowing how long I'd be gone. I reached out to one of my good friends, gave him a passcode so that he could make sure my bills were paid while I was gone. Came by and seen my family and told my wife at the time, because we were still married, even though I was living with someone else, that I had a problem. I was going to get help. So I took that bottle of whiskey, buckled it in the passenger seat, and I said, you're not controlling me no more. I drove about 5 hours to North Alabama to rehab in Warrior, Alabama, and checked myself in. And so then I began the rehab process.
Wow. That's that's pretty powerful. You put that bottle right there on the seat next to you. That's very symbolic. And I think that's probably, that's the fighter. I think that's in all cops, right? There's a part of us that, that's always looking for the fight. That's always looking for the engagement. So you get into rehab, and then the first step in rehab is what?
We get into rehab, and the first step is the first few days you're there, you're doing detox. Mind you, I never opened that bottle. I left it there. When I got there, they check your vehicle and you and make sure you don't have anything. They poured it out. So I never drank it. I just kept looking at it and saying, you're not going to control me no more. So then when I got there, you do 2 to 3 days of detox. And then you start doing different session meetings and things with the group, which was very difficult going in as a cop. One reason I wanted to go to 5 hours away is I didn't want to be in a rehab with someone that I had put in. Well, that didn't quite work. So when I got there, there was one or two people that knew me in my group home. I'll call it a group home. I'm really not sure what you want to call it. It was a house. Each person had a bedroom, and then you have meeting rooms. So the second morning that I was in the house, we came out for our morning meeting. After they check your bed, make sure you make your bed, they put rules in place. What they do is they start giving you that structure that you are missing. So you begin your structure of doing what they tell you. As a police officer, that was the toughest part. It was not dealing with the people that I had put in there with me that was there because of an arrest I had made with them. We actually, some of us became really good friends and still talk till this day. But as they give you that structure and you have no control over what time you're getting up, what time you're eating, what you're eating, you're doing what they're telling you to give you that structure. That began the process. After settling in, that was the toughest part of the process. I did around 15 days inpatient. Then I came home and did outpatient rehab. I came home and another agency gave me a chance while I was still completing my outpatient rehab. I was very upfront with them, told them I was still doing my outpatient. They gave me an opportunity. So I took the things I had learned about structuring my life from rehab and begin the new steps of dealing with stress daily, getting up, making sure I made my bed. I still make my bed to this morning every day. Even if I go out of town to a hotel, I make the bed. So I continued to use that structure. That's when I got into going to a peer support class. I went to one in Mississippi. I came back and wanted to learn a little more about the peer support because I'm still changing. They tell you for that year not to make no big adjustments as you're fixing yourself. So during that year, I continued to live in the home by myself, and my wife lived in our marital home to give me that space and to rebuild myself. She would come see me, stay with me some, but we still had that year because they had told us, take a year, structure yourself. So she gave me that window and sat back and just asked, what can I do to help? And so as that process went on, she became my rock, like she should have been in the first on my behalf. I'm not saying that she wasn't there like she should have been. I allowed her to be where she was supposed to be, the rock, instead of going somewhere else. I then went to another peer support class because I was very interested in peer support in Alabama. At the time, Alabama did not have peer support. Then they came and got peer support. So I attended the third peer support class. All these classes are anywhere from 32 to 40 hours. So I took all those tools and began to just learn how to deal with stress, how to have a better family life. I still was interested in becoming better because you just wanted to reach another level. So I got me a mentor. He worked with me a while. And so then I was like, well, there's one more level out there, which is where we're at today, the coaching. So then I learned how to become a coach and became a coach, you know, with Axon Coaching. A lot of that process is just taking your daily tools and dealing with things daily and not letting them build up.
The peer support program that is in place now in Alabama didn't exist when you were going through this, did it?
No, peer support in Alabama just came out, I want to say 3 years ago. So when I started my career, I'd never heard of peer support. I'd never any of those things. Of course, they told us about the EA, you know, employee assisted program, but they never had peer support then. I only learned about peer support programs when I got back from rehab in 2015. Of course, by then I'd done been in the business for over 15 years. I'd already went down the path that you didn't need to go down.
Yeah. And, you know, here in Indiana, the Indianapolis Metro PD, they have a national model for peer support that they really do have an amazing program. And I think maybe, you know, for the law enforcement listeners, you know, if you don't have a peer support program, then it's certainly a long past time to start looking about what are the best practices and how do you get that started? Because there is a difference, right? It's not EAP. It's separate from EAP. They work together. But, and again, what you mentioned there at the end is coaching. I think, you know, coaching there's a very distinctive difference between mentoring, EAP, peer support, and then what a coaching program is, because ultimately what we're hoping to be able to do from a coaching perspective is, you know, go backwards and before you go forwards, right? So I maybe as a profession, I guess, is a better way to say that, in terms of giving people the right information and the right tools in advance of taking on, not, I mean, we're not even talking about narcotics, you know, that's just a whole new, that's next level layer of stress and trauma that you're trying to process. But just being a police officer in general, you know, there's a reason why athletes use coaching. There's a reason why executives use coaching, right? Because it's effective, it works, and we can give people the right tools to hopefully prevent, you know, the mistakes that those before us have made, but then also to have things like EAP and peer support and mentor programs that, you know, in the inevitability, because, you know, nothing's bulletproof, right?
Yes, I definitely agree that the peer support programs are great. We are blessed in Alabama. They travel through the state and teach them now. So I am very glad we have those. But like you said, they're to deal with your one-on-one with each other. I've been there. This is how I made it. And then you go to the next level of mentor, then coaching. And again, like you said, coaching, you know, our goal is to get you to the best performing officer at home in the community that you can be. So once we coach you, if your home life is good, when you get to work, you're going to get along with the employees. Also, if you're in a good state of mind, you're going to treat the community good and you're going to have a good relationship instead of coming to work worried about finances or worried about things that you're doing that you don't need to do or stressing over who's getting promoted, those things that you cannot control. I think you're just going to be a lot better officer. Again, I think the peer support is great for, you know, we go to a call and there's unexpected trauma there and we deal with that trauma. Because definitely as a coach, and I think you would agree, if you come to me as a coach and I see that you still have trauma, I'm going to refer you to get help through your local peer support. If you don't have one, we're going to find you one. Our job is to take you to the next level, but to take you to the next level, you've got to already dealt with all the things in the past. We want to give you the tools and make you a better person, but you have to be in a good state of mind in order for coaching to work. So I think coaching can also change your career path if we got the young officer at the beginning and under, and then you let the coach coach you and you understand where you want to go in your career. I think if we could start getting young officers at the beginning, that would be the best point.
Okay, so let's, one of the things I like to talk about or think about in this, the theme of Coptimizer is how do you build, if you could, like, if you were building Frankenstein in a lab, right? Maybe, I don't know, maybe Frankenstein's not a good, maybe he's not a good example, but you're going to create, if you're going to build this, what you, in your vision would be the perfect cop, right? Now you take all your years of experience and the lessons that you've learned, many the hard way, right? You're going to go back to your 20-year-old self. What are some of the things that you tell yourself, or if you could, you know, if you had a little reboot, what might you do differently, or how would you take this concept then of coaching and apply it to your younger self?
Good point. So what I would do first is I would make sure I had structure. So I start the day out now reading something positive after I make my bed and I make sure my room is good to go. So I set that mindset of a positive day. So then you leave your home and your mind's in a positive. I don't try to bring the negatives from yesterday. As I get to work, I'll try to talk with everybody that's at work, see how they're doing, just what's going on with them, whether it's work-related, personal. We work through our shifts. On the way home now, what I do is I just take a few minutes to decompress. You get home now, and when you're in a good state, you speak to your wife. You tell her, hey, how's your day going? You talk to her just for a few minutes about how your day went. And don't traumatize her with your day. So if you had a bad situation, just give her a brief about it. Because that secondhand trauma, if you go into detail, now she's trauma. So just give her a brief. Then move along to your personal life. One of the big things that I learned now, having three live here. The other one's in England. So wow. We don't get to see him much. We just got back from England, which was great. So we spent a little time with him. But backing up, when you get home, one of the big things that you've got to do is let go of that badge. So when the grandbabies are running around being grandbabies, instead of hollering at them and trying to control what they're doing and let it be a little chaos. You got to have that little chaos in your life at home there. Instead of trying to control it like you're at a scene, quit being a cop. So we do things like that differently. One of the other big things that we see now is we take time to ourselves outdoors. We go do things, the wife and I. Sometimes if we are getting ready to go eat here locally, I'm not sure about you, but you go to a restaurant and you sit outside for an hour. You're playing with your phone. You're not really talking. So what we do now is we'll look for a restaurant that's, you know, an hour away. We'll get in the car, put our phones down, not mess with them for that hour drive. And we use that as talking time instead of sitting in a lobby talking about everybody else. We have dinner. We check our phones, make sure nobody's tried to reach out to us for anything. Then we drive back and we have our conversation. So again, you just got to have some structure in how you're dealing with what you see. Also, I believe that you need to, you know, talk to someone at least once a year to get rid of any built up stress you have. Make sure it's gone. Make sure you've dealt with it. Then another angle that you can look at is when you start looking at yourself healthy. I now take a couple of vitamins each day. When I went to rehab, I was about 235, 40 pounds roughly. I average about 185, 190 now and have been since rehab because I don't not just eat what I want. I just watch what I eat. So really just putting some plans in place to make sure that you're separating that badge and that home life.
Yeah, that's a really descriptive and very specific protocol. And I love it. I love it because I can share the same thing that I didn't always have that type of structure, right? Sometimes the day owns you rather than you owning right. The day. And, you know, certainly there are times when that's just, it's unavoidable in this profession, but I think it's a, and again, there is a lot of data to support why having that structure early in your day, why you start making your bed, you know, that's first victory, right? That's your day moving in a positive direction and simplifying things to avoid the emotional overload. Because everything, and I think probably, and maybe you've read this book, but we're very fortunate in our area here that we have we have good peer support resources. We have good EAP programs. We've got, but I think probably one of our greatest resources is a local. He's a minister. He's a pastor. He's a comedian. He's also got his master's in psychology, and he also has had his life saved by first responders. And so he right. spends his time giving back, but he talks a lot about the concepts that Kevin Gilmartin really highlights in his book, Emotional Survival for Law Enforcement. But he actually gave me a book. I read a lot, but he gave me a book that I had not heard of before by a guy named Bessel van der Kolk, and it was called The Body Keeps the Score. And if you've never read it, I would encourage you to read this, but it really is kind of the, a great work on understanding how stress and trauma builds over time. And that if you don't have managed release for this, it's going to express itself one way or another. And I certainly don't need to talk about, well, I guess I do need to talk about it. I don't need to tell you, but most people just are not aware about how unhealthy our police population is. And the rates of type 2 diabetes, of insulin resistance, of cardiovascular disease, all these things are, it's not an accident, right? Yeah, I mean, there is a pathological process that is occurring over time, and the clock starts ticking, right at the beginning of your career and even before that, right? And it never stops. So it's really about, the decisions that you make in terms of putting structure into your day early in your career are really going to add value and time on the back end, right? So you get to enjoy that retirement.
That's correct. You really set a good example there. And to just let people know that when you get that structure, you will get those rewards. When I came back and I had that structure, I was able to work myself all the way up to an assistant director of a department before leaving, going to my current department as a patrolman. So I was able to come back. Everyone locally knew about me, knew what I had done. I went through the steps to better myself and work myself all the way to assistant director. The current agency that I'm at you know, because of my past, you know, with the personnel board, there was issues that first I couldn't get hired. And when I didn't get hired the first time, I just kept improving myself, adding value. I didn't get hired the second time. This is all within a couple of years span. I just kept adding value. The third time finally worked out. So another thing that I would encourage you is if you do come forward and you fix your problems, just be very transparent about them. I'm fortunate to work for a new chief that knew me through my entire career. But his thought process is, Alan, you've been sober. You've been on a great path for 7 years. How long do we hold that against you? So we definitely got to get more administrators to look at it that way too. 7 years is a long time. But during that process, just keep adding value to yourself. When it didn't work out at this agency, I never said nothing bad. And now I work for that agency. Again, I really applaud the administration for knowing my past, but saying, you know what, you've paid your debts and dues for being bad. You've done what you're supposed to for 7 years. How long do we not give you that opportunity? So by giving me an opportunity, we now can look at others within the department and other agents and say, look, yeah, you chose a bad path. You didn't deal with things right. But when you start getting it right, you will be rewarded in time. Stay the course, keep the faith, keep moving. So again, I really applaud the administration for being bold and taking the chance to say, you know, yeah, he was bad, but look at him now.
Yeah, and we did talk a little bit about this too before we recorded, and it's such a fascinating conversation because, you know, as an administrator, you're also thinking, and you rose to that position, right? So you know, you know, there are responsibilities that you have to your organization, to your city and your community, where there has to be a level of accountability as well. So for, you know, for an individual that is, you know, that's had some missteps along the way, you know, maybe, you know, there are certain things that people might do that are going to permanently disqualify them from being able to work in the profession again. We know what those things are. Those are statutory limitations, you know, federal case law limitations. But then, the administrator also has, you know, it's that tightrope that you're trying to walk in, a balancing act where you're trying to make sure that you're providing the resources and the right opportunities for people that, you know, maybe have made a mistake. But, you know, that all starts with accountability. And, when I hear you speak, one of the things that, you know, that is clear is that, you know, you've accepted what your role in all of this was. You know, one of the reasons why you were, separated or divorced multiple times, why you lost a job. And then also why, you know, maybe someone was willing to take a chance on you, knowing what your past is. So, I mean, what would your advice be to those that maybe have had, you know, some similar pitfalls in terms of, you know, what's the process? How do I fight my way back?
Well, the first thing you got to do is admit that you got a problem, whatever that problem is, whether you got a problem with alcohol, infidelity, finances. A lot of times we see it's finances and you're overworking yourself. So whatever the problem is, admit that you've got it. Sit down with someone to begin working on healing that problem. A big thing you got to understand during that process is you created that chaos by decisions you made. So when you start healing, you're still going to get some repercussions from that. I accepted. One of the big things that I did when I first got back is from rehab, I sat down with my wife and I told her every infidelity I'd had to the best of my ability. And I said, you have an hour to ask me any questions and let's close that door. I put it out there. As the process goes, I still have to realize from time to time, my wife, because of what I created, may see me do something that I used to do. And she may say, are you back to being bad? No, I'm not. So, and you got to accept that. You can't get mad. So those challenges are going to be there. So know that they're going to be there. So I accepted all that. One of the big things I've done as an administrator and as an employee, when I first went back from got back from rehab and got hired at this agency, we are world's worst at law enforcement to gossip about what you hear, what you think you heard, what's going to happen. So what I've done, I put in place in my head, when I started this agency, I made it a point to go to every officer that worked there, because it was a smaller agency, tell them everything about my past. That way, they wouldn't hear it. If they went to a meeting somewhere and they heard something, they'd say, wait a minute, you left this part out. When I got ready to hire and I was doing interviews as the assistant director, a new hire, I would tell them, because they're going to go tell their friend, well, I'm going to work over here and this is who interviewed me. And if their friend might be in law enforcement or might have heard about me in the area, they're going to tell them. Transparent. By being so transparent, you let the people know, hey, I made mistakes. So if you got a problem, come see me. I understand. Now, there are certain things that I cannot help you with, that if you make those decisions, that is your career, like you said earlier. But I want them to know, just because I have made it to an administrator, that I'm not perfect. There's going to be mistakes. But if you lie to me, I'm done. So I was very transparent. I found that to be very open. And even as I came to this new agency, I'm very transparent. Somebody say, hey, what took you so long to be here? And I say, well, because I used to drink too much and infidelity. But I'm retired. I'm retired from both of those now. And I'm living a good life. So you got to be very transparent, accept it. Get that structure. Again, I think if we get the new officer at the beginning and get that structure, we would see so much better of a high-performing officer, because they're not at work worried about finances. Again, they're not worried about what they're doing. They're not working so hard that they got to have overtime to pay their bills. So it's just getting them that structure at the beginning and being transparent and healing from any issues they had, which was part of my healing process. I didn't deal with some trauma as a kid, and I just continue to carry it. So first step, deal with that trauma, come back, get you some structure, be transparent. If you make that mistake, be transparent. Now when I'm working, even when it comes to the streets, I'm talking to someone and they got an addiction problem, I can say, I'll tell them, hey, I understand. I got what we call the Sober Tool app, and I'll show them on my phone. We're human too. So how can I help you get better? What do you think you need to do? So I'd use it not only in law enforcement, but day to day when I'm out here with the community. Also, just that transparency with your community about, yeah, I made a mistake. If you come and you're investigating something for them as a police officer or deputy, whatever your role is, they're not hearing from people. So the transparency and structure is really big there.
Yeah, it's such a fascinating path, and I think people are fortunate to have the ability to, you know, ask questions or see, you know, kind of like, you know, what's the path if I don't make good decisions? But I think maybe the most important concept might be is the understanding that, you know, we're all, you know, in public safety, there's what you're getting into, at least you should, you know, when you go through the hiring process, when you're thinking about entering this profession, we need people that are willing to take on, you know, that, you know, that lifestyle and, you know, and that, you know, quite frankly, you know, that trauma, they need to be able to carry it in order to be able to be of use in their communities and to help. But, you know, at the same time, you always have to be accountable to yourself as well, right? I mean, it all, you know, all starts with you. And I always, you know, the D.H. Lawrence poem, it's called self-pity. Maybe you've heard this before, but this I had heard when I was, I think one of the first time I saw this was when I was in high school, and it just kind of, it, you know, when I was young, it didn't really stick with me. It wasn't until, you know, later in life when you've had a little bit of adversity, it kind of comes back and, it resonates a little bit more, but it goes something along the lines, a small bird will die frozen from a bough without ever having felt sorry for itself. You know, so, you know, if you think about that on a cold winter day, you know, just the bird's just the bird, right? The bird's just living the bird life. I mean, and, you know, if it freezes to death because it can't find food or shelter, then build a shelter, or its shelter gets destroyed, then, you know, it's done. You know, that's just the way life is. And, you know, if the bird doesn't feel sorry for itself, you know, wild, you know, at least as far as we know, right? Maybe it does. Maybe it's sitting there on that branch going, oh, shit.
Yeah.
I'm tired. I'm hungry. I'm cold. But, you know, the lesson being is that we're, you know, we've got to be responsible for ourselves. And if we dig a hole, you know, we got to find a way out. You know, and I think from an agency perspective, if we can, you know, give people the tools to help them from preventing them from digging those holes in the first place. But if they do find themselves in a hole, hopefully there's, we can offer them a way out. Right.
Right. Definitely got to have something in place. You know, that could be a whole nother episode on structure and how I go about my daily life to maintain from not going back. That can be a whole nother. That's a deep subject and how detailed it is. But I think we need to put programs in place that have those details and have our officers listen to them and talk to people about it. And moving along to where you said, having a program in place. If you do something, we got to let them know. Come forward, accountability, transparency. But yeah, you might have to, bite the backlash from it because you made that decision. Let's get it out here. Let's get it aired out. Let's get it fixed before it gets too bad. Not everyone will be so blessed to have a wife that went through all that with me and stayed at home because she told me, she said, I know you can be a good person. You're just not dealing with things right. Not everyone will have that good rock that will stay there. You could lose one of the best important people in your life during those decisions. I was blessed. I am blessed. Fortunate that my wife stood there and waited for me to fix myself. Not everyone has that opportunity.
Well, I put myself on the spot a second ago when I was trying to quote a D.H. Lawrence poem. And I forgot the first line. I've never seen a wild thing sorry for itself. A small bird will drop frozen dead from a bough without ever having felt sorry for itself. So that's the poem, but it sounds like that's kind of the path that you've taken, you know, and you've had that understanding. So so maybe tell us a little bit about some of the training that you've been going through, you know, outside of, we know that you've gone through the coaching program and now you're working as a coach, but what were some of the peer training courses that you went through that you sought out on your own after you got out of, when you were a recoverer?
Well, at first I went to, no one local had one. So I went to Meridian and it was Mississippi LEAPS, which is offered to us through the Regional Counter Drug Training Academy. It's government. They give us the training, the housing. So then I come back and kept reading some more, kept in contact with the instructor. And then I reached out and did what they call Under the Shield. Susan, she's actually from out in the Arizona area. The wife and I both went to it. Then I came back. And at that time, after I told everybody about it, that's when some people went to the Mississippi one, got the same training. Then they come back and got legislative pass for Alabama to have the protection, you know, so if you talk to me, I don't record it. I don't have to tell nobody what you said. Then they started Alabama LEAPS, then went to Alabama LEAPS. During those processes, I just started reading different material that I could find, which is now I read a lot. Those days that I was not doing what I was supposed to, I didn't read a book. The wife always read, and I'm like, all you do is read books. So now that role reversed. So I'm sitting over here reading books while she's coloring her picture. So I really just sought out what is out there. And during that process, I recently met a new friend, Jonathan Hickory, out in Virginia. I started following Jonathan, and Jonathan actually had been down the same path as me. And then he wrote a book called Break Every Chain. It later became a movie. So it's about a 14-hour drive. So on his premiere, the wife and I drove out, spent some time with him, met him, and it's now a movie called Break Every Chain. His sobriety date is within 5 days of mine, and our paths are about the same. So he has a book and a movie that is great. So I continued to be able to maintain finding people that had been down that path and ask them how you're doing it, what they're doing. Again, a lot of that comes back to just giving myself and the wife structure on our daily life, getting up, making the bed. We don't have a TV in the room when we get ready to go to bed. So maintaining those tools and then reaching out to others that have been down that path and seeing how they've done it and learning some of their tools.
Well, that's that prefrontal cortex, right? learn from the mistakes of others, learn those lessons. So, you know, hopefully that's something, you know, that we're accomplishing on this show today. And maybe if there's a listener out there that's in an agency that doesn't have these resources, you know, there's a place to start and start digging. But I think maybe because we're getting closer to the end. So if we think about, you know, the path moving forward, and we talked about the coaching program, I think it's important to kind of go back to that again, to think about, you know, if you were building an agency from the ground up, right? You know, the old saying is that youth is wasted on the young. And, you know, I shouldn't say a little bit of truth. There's probably a lot of truth to that, right? Because, you know, when we're young, sometimes we don't necessarily understand the long-term ramifications for the decisions that we're making. But, you know, we still have to live with them, whether we understood them or not. And so there's that reconciliation that has to occur, that, you know, I'm responsible. But from an agency perspective, wow, you know, as you're traveling around now, and, you know, you get to tell your story, but, you know, what your story also offers is an alternate path. Like, you know, you know, your officers they don't need to go down the path of Alan Hendrickson. I've done it for you. So let me show you what's at the end of that.
Well, if I was building an agency now, and, you know, I have talked to some agencies, I would be sure that there was an officer wellness program, including coaching, in place. I understand that small agencies might not can afford to have one person just do it. So then that's where you get into an agency that's bigger that does it for your area, and they help other agencies. Definitely, if you would have a wellness performance coaching program in place, you're an officer today. Where do you plan to be in 5 years, personally and professionally? One of the great things I like about our coaching program with Axon is that we also do the spousal coaching, so they're included. So they are an law enforcement officer. No matter what you say, your wife or your husband, if you are an officer, they are too, because they deal with it every day. They do the little perks of going in the restaurant, looking all around. They know where you want to sit. They know that if you say a certain word at a dinner table somewhere in a restaurant, get up, get gone, there's a problem. They live that same stuff. So we need to take them at the beginning again and put these programs in place in the beginning.
Yeah. And I think for people that are not associated with law enforcement or in cops, that, you know, they just don't, it's just not something that processes with them. Like, they just, when you try to explain it to them, it's just like, man, if you haven't experienced it, sometimes it's just hard to, it's hard to get it. And sometimes these things, and to be, I think, to be frank about it, I think some of these threats and boogeymen are created, you know, through myth and legend, and some of it creates an unnecessary level of, I think, suspicion, you know, and that can be problematic in and of itself. But then, you know, the sad thing is for every one of these things, again, we go back to that, you know, the old adage that there's a little bit of truth to it, right? You know, we've seen, sadly, the increase in the number of ambushes that are happening. You know, the fact that spouses and family members have the opportunity to participate, I think, is huge, because that's, you know, I know there are probably some agencies that have been doing that, have been well ahead of the curve, but you know, that's very atypical. So that's a very, I think that's a very unique part of that program. I don't want to keep you all day, because I've got so many paths that we could take. I think, you know, here, if I had to, you know, maybe summarize what we talked about in today's show, it's that, you know, maybe the understanding that the past can derail the future. But if you hold on to the past and you can't, you know, find a way to look forward, then it's going to prevent new opportunities from coming. And so if you, by engaging with a coaching program, by developing a good routine, adding structure to your life, and being, I think, very intentional about what your path is going to be, we can avoid a lot of the pitfalls that are there. I mean, because they're there, they haven't gone away. And I don't think they're ever going away, right? The dangers and the pitfalls of this job, you know, and you know, I guess maybe that's how I would summarize it. What would you, I mean, any kind of like just closing thoughts, or, you know, a piece of advice or a piece of wisdom that you want to drop on the audience before we hang it up today?
I would just tell everyone out there, take care of yourself first. Then everything else will come where it needs to be. If you're not in a good state of mind, physically and mentally, then nothing else is going to fall right. You've got to take care of yourself, and then the other things will come in time. Keep the path, keep the faith, even when you hit those rocky spots. Like you said, those pitfalls are there. They're going to never go away. They were created with the job when it was created. The alcoholism, the stress, those things were created. The women, the men that you meet, people that love the badge to be able to be with you, all that was created over the years, and it's not going away. Get in front of the curve and not become one of those that had to do the path that I did to learn the hard way.
Well, well said, well said. And I know I've said it before, this profession is good at breaking, does a good job of breaking good people. So, you know, your story, I think, is kind of a light in the darkness. You know, it shows people that with resilience and determination, that even if you stumble, even if you fall, there is hope. You know, there's always a way out, right? And that's, I think that's maybe the most important thing for people to remember. The resources are around now. If they're not at your agency, don't ever hesitate to reach out to other agencies in your area. You know, if you're struggling with something, you know, don't struggle alone, right? And for all of our brothers and sisters out there, you know, make sure that you're checking in with each other, making sure everyone's doing all right. I think that's all I got, man. That's like that. It's such a powerful story, and you know, hats off to you. I really do appreciate you sharing it, because I know that can be personal, and you know, it takes a lot of guts to, you know, stand up in front of people and talk about things that you know well, let alone talk about things that you know that are personal to you. So your story, I think, will go a long way in helping others to realize that the, you know, there's always a path forward.
I enjoyed it, and I definitely hope our conversation helps others. That is the whole goal.
That is the goal. All right. Well, that's going to conclude this episode of the Captimizer podcast. Thank you, everybody, for listening. Thanks, Alan, for being here with us today. Until the next episode, I'll be 1042. Log into www.performance-protocol and learn more about how to bring this program to your agency and community.